Hi, everyone. All right, let's get started. This is our last webinar of the series. We're going to do some introductions and some housekeeping, and we'll go right into the slides and demos, and then we'll end up with some questions. Let's see, before we begin, remember we're going to send you a link to the recording so you don't have to take notes. I would love to have your questions anytime that you want to ask them, put them in the question or the chat area, and we'll do some Q&A when we can and definitely at the end. And there are three handouts available. Let's see, what did we put there? The slides, of course, and a page with some links that we talk about during the show, and the new beta release, the 2020 R2 that was just finished today. So our speakers today, of course, are me, Marilyn Prince, and you know me, and then Massimo Bertoli is our CTO and president, and he'll be doing most of the talking. And as a matter of fact, I'm going to hand it over to you, Massimo.
Okay. Thank you, everybody, to come today. And I want to let me introduce something about at least what are the main concepts of object-oriented. When we designed in Scoreboard in the late 2004, basically, we decided to adopt a high-level language like Java, because mostly because this language give us a nice and very nice way to write code in object-oriented. Object-oriented helps us a lot to provide a product with a lot of feature, but giving a good level of quality and a few number of bugs. And just because, of course, object-oriented force you to write code in a specific way. And the main things are, like the slide described, modularity. Modularity basically means that objects are self-contained and they have with functionality, of course, and they can stay alone and run it, but they can interact with other objects without any kind of problem. You can reuse the code to the inner intents that basically allow you to start from a code that you have written and reuse it again, but for different flavor with different things. But the code basically is the same. So, of course, also the problem solving become simple or simpler because when you wrote in object-oriented, you're decomposing the complex problem in smaller chunk of components. And so that definitely is a good practice in the programming of today. Object-oriented programming force you to do that. And so it helps to create a good thing. The nice things for us that we discover, you can take advantage of this because, next slide, please, Marilyn. Because we discover there is a very well support of the object-oriented from the very beginning. So with our language, with our COBOL, you can define classes with method and date implemented stay in COBOL. You can create instance of Java and COBOL classes in the same time. So, but basically, you can take advantage of the Java and COBOL cooperation. So you can invoke methods on Java from COBOL and vice versa. You can, in COBOL, wrote classes that inherits again from Java things and change stuff or create and define overloaded methods. So just to give you, this is create at the end a lot of flexibility in the picture of the language. Scoreboard support many aspects or syntax of ANSI standard COBOL of 2014, and also we extend many of the syntax to give a better and better support for object. Basically, with Scoreboard, you can create an object-oriented without any limitation compared to other language, modern language of today that support object-oriented. In the next step, I want to show you a demo where I will start from a Java source. Let me show my screen. This is a Mac, but we can switch on a PC. Most of you people maybe use a PC, a Windows PC, but our product is multi-platform, so you can use the product where you like, Windows, Linux, or Macintosh. But basically, most of the time you can have, you can find the code example on Google just to accomplish complex tasks. Most of the time, the examples are written in modern language like Java. So this is an example, for example, and maybe your intention could be, how can I can do the same in this COBOL? In this specific example, the topics that is managed is basically deal with the time zone. The time zone is things that is not easy, it's not complex at all, but it definitely is not easy to be managing, staying COBOL, because there is different stuff that need to be dealt. For example, in this specific example, the code in a simple way try to create instance of a Rome time zone and America Los Angeles time zone, and at the end try to get the result to know how much hour there is of difference there is between two these different time zones. This could be done in Java with a few lines. That is at the end, if you run it, what we can see is the result. And let me run as a Java application. Okay. And so the result will be the program reports what is the current data. I am in Italy, so my time is 16:04 p.m. In Los Angeles, Maryland time is 7 a.m. And so the program, with a simple method invocation, give you what is the number of hour of difference between the my time zone and Maryland time zone. So what we can do? How we can do the same in scope in COBOL? Let me show an example. Basically, the same code I want to show comparing, so just to you can keep basically how similar is the COBOL. So in the first area we have the repository Java using import to use internal classes, and is COBOL, and COBOL definitely the standard define a repository. But you see here we have four import of four different objects, and the same are inside in COBOL, same repository, same stuff, nothing different. The COBOL is more strong to define the data. COBOL wants to have things defined in the working story section. Java, instead, you can, of course, define the data, but you can also define data where you like. Sometimes people love these things, sometimes it's not so good. Definitely, we are COBOL people, so we love the idea that data are pretty defined in the right place, that is the working storage. As you see here, zone one, that is basically a zone ID object. This is the same. We have zone one that is an object reference of zone ID object. Zone ID is definitely the classes of Java time zone ID. And so looking in the code, you can see that basically the statement are pretty similar statement. We have here the statement that allow us to get the time zone. So we are in zone one, we receive and we save the object that basically is for to represent the Europa Rome time zone. In zone two we have Los Angeles, so we do some method invocation in order to get the data. And of course basically the main purpose of this example is to know the difference between the time zone. And to know the difference, there is a cron unit, object invocation, hours, and between methods that basically these methods wants to have as parameters the zone ID to be compiled. And so we can run this program, but basically we have the same result. So as you see, there is no additional lines, no delay, no layer, because when we generate code, we generate in the COBOL, in the Java, that we generate exactly the object method that we call. So the result is the same. So with just few lines of code, that of course is object-oriented code, you can resolve a complex task, like to manage a time zone, to manage a timer, to manage, but you know, you can use any kind of Java internal methods or internal classes to resolve any kind of issue that you can have in your COBOL program. And the nice thing is that this COBOL program is a COBOL program. So you can put there and use from your legacy COBOL program, call it or invoke it without be forced to have 100% of your common applications written object oriented. You can have 99% written in a legacy way, just one little pieces that is written in object oriented just to resolve this special task. So this is important for me that I want to show, because object oriented, later we will see in the demo many things to deal with this combo that with thanks to object oriented that they become very easy, very powerful to be resolved. Go ahead, Madeline. So, how customize Scopel? Scopel can be easy customized. What means customize? Customize means we want to do some change in the default behavior of Scopel without basically ask to Scopel developers or to us in order to provide a change. For example, I put here just some idea, but basically most of the times people ask us that they want to change the images that we provide in the product. Many user interface that we have single icon or images that can maybe people loves maybe different color, different shapes, so and usually because we design this interface, we force in some way to use this kind of images. Same thing like for the text message. You see there is many messages that come from COBOL, like error message or any kind of message. We localize the message for each language that we supported. However, maybe there is a situation where you want to have your personalized message. We do basically, we give you the capability to change our standard message. So you change our standard icons or images as well, re-implemented, for example, the message box. In a recent 2020 R2 beta, we provide this capability to re-implement, totally re-implement the message box of the system. Look and feel. Java support look and feel. It means that your user interface of COBOL application can be different when it runs on a Unix or Windows or Macintosh, or can be changed if you use a different LAF. Because Java support LAF, is COBOL support LAF as well, but also, what I want to show you in the next demo is basically how to start from a standard LAF and enhance it and change it a little bit without basically go in your COBOL application and do all the changes. Next slide, please. Other area of customization of COBOL are what we call it internal object. Many areas we have internal objects that can be referenced directly from your COBOL application to customize the things that we provide. Like for example, Scopel provide a very nice print preview feature. So your print output that usually is sent to the printer can be easily shown to the screen or sent to a PDF without any effort. But our user interface maybe have things that you don't like, or you want to have different color. And again, this object, in case of print spooler object, allow you to customize totally for the print preview. We have also the current data that is another internal classes that if you like to run the application with a different data and time, without going the system and change the data, you can go there and define what is the data that your application need to run. This is just a few examples, but in many other areas, like we support other way or methodology to change what are and to customize the Scopel. For example, WinDollar Printer, that is the API that we use to define the GUI printing, the printing form. You can specify attributes for PDF creation to provide additional stuff in the PDF, like the owner that created the PDF, like to embed the font, think any kind of a customization. Recently, in the coming beta, we announced the WinDollar menu in order to, with some attribute, to provide a different style of menu to be shown in your application. Give me the control of the machine that I can show you what I've explained. Okay, this is still my Macintosh. Let's go in the IDE. Let's start from, we can start from how to customize the images. So in order to customize these messages and the text message of Scoble, first we need to understand in which way Scoble is the jar file of Scoble is created. You see here, here is the standard distribution of Scoble. There's a lot of jar file that are basically more or less necessary to when you run a Cobol application. But the biggest, the most important, is what we call the Scoble.jar. Jar file are zip files. So I open it with WinRAR, and you can see what is included in the jar file. But you see there is a lot of packages. We work to enhance Scoble in so many years, so you see many, many code inside it. But in order to change the GUI image, you need to go in a special package that is the GUI package, stay on the client side, and in the case of desktop, Zwing is the right package for you. The package, you see there is many classes that you cannot care, but in the very back, the very bottom, there is basically images. Images are images that are that basically we use in our application. In which way we use these images? Let me run an example first. This example show you is part of our distribution. Is a very good start point to understand, technically speaking, how Sync works. So this is basically last feature that we provided in 2020 beta. As you see, this is the way, is a grid component where we can, with Control F, you can search things inside the component. But I want to be focused on the image first. So you see here, there is icons that are gray because we decided to make gray, but basically I'm gray. And so my idea is how we can do changes images, of course, without going in the jar file and hack it and remove it. Because for example, the sort, the major search is search find, you see, this is basically the image of sort. And so this is the image that we use. So the good practice in this specific case to change image and also to change messages, of course, define where they are, and we define the images, and to define message, we can go in another package that is RTS, that is basically the base runtime. And in RTS, there are all a list of property file that contains basically all messages that we provide. As you see, the property file are Scoble messages, and there is a suffix that is basically the language. So you see, we support many languages, but maybe there is language that we don't support. So first of all, if you use Scoble, you want to change and your language is not supported, you can go, you can create yours property file to define message. And so let me see and show, I prepare a directory here that reflects the structure of Scoble. So here we have the GUI, so new icons that I want to show basically are the same one with the different colors, the same that we use in the grid with some just blue instead of gray. And the message. So the message is an RTS package. So we can go in the message. The property file are text file. So the important thing of property file are they are basically a key. There is a key and there is a value. Because and you need to keep the key, because the key, we use the key. So you don't change the key, please. Otherwise, the message doesn't work anymore. But you can change what you say on the right of the key, so the message. So for example, the message okay, that now is okay, I can say okay, okay, double okay, just to show you something of change, so that is different. And now, what is the good practice to force Scoble to use that message that I have defined? First of all, is create these things in a jar file. And we can do easily with a command. We have in the distribution a special folder named jars where you can put your jars. And here I see this is my jar. And I want to pack in this jar all things that are under com folder. So I put the images, I put property. So the idea is in which way Scoble take advantage of this jar file? What everything that you put in the jar in jars directory is loaded in the class path in advance with our jar things. So it means that Scoble when runs first will load these things and then we will load other stuff that are under lib folder. So if we rerun a sample application, let me close and rerun. So I don't change nothing in Scopus. I just run it, put in this jar file, and I say Control F today. And so you see the change of the icon. The icon now are blue because the jar file, things that are on jars folder are loaded in advance. Think like this is for images, so you can change all images that we use, but also you can change the message box. Now we in this version, we enhance a lot the message box. So you see now, as you see, this is the custom message box, and you see that basically the push button say okay, double okay, because this is my change. But you can change it, you understand? You can change any kind of things. The nice thing of this version of Scopus that we can customize also the message box. So in other words, you can say, without going to a Scopus application and change the display message box statement, you can set up Scopus in a way to load your message box. Your message box is defined from you, so you can decide it the way that you like. For example, in this example, we decided to have a flat message box with a color according to the flavor of the type of message box. Let me see. If it's a warning, the color is yellow. If it's a error message box, the color is red, of course. But you can do what you like. Of course, the change that you do are just a customization of Scopus. You don't need to go in your application to do nothing. So you can change the standard message, the standard icon, you can change the standard message, you can change the standard message box, you create your own message box. Let me show now something about the look and feel. Look and feel is an example here that we can open. Couple programs when you run have a look and feel. I'm on Windows now, so I'm expected to have the Windows look and feel. So if you run, I'm sorry, this is need to change a little bit. Next example, configuration. Otherwise, you see already the result of my things. So when you run, you can decide that which kind of look and feel the application can execute. So system is the default look and feel. And in this specific case, it means a Windows look and feel because I'm on Windows. So the file is a small font. The font is the font that you defined in Windows system. The push button are push button on Windows and so on. Of course, Java allows you to define the look and feel that you like. And so in order to do the feel that you like, you can go, there is an option to define a meta look and feel, motif, and nimbus, for example. I show nimbus because it's different. You see there is a different things in the menu, the color, the push button, the button are little rounded. So look and feel give you the capability to change the look of the application without going the application and do change. But what I like to underline that you can do also what you like. So with minimal knowledge of object-oriented or Java, but you know, I wrote this in Java, but it can be written also in COBOL as well with object-oriented without any complexity. You have basically, the idea is basically start from a standard look and feel that is the meta look and feel of Java and extend it. Extend it means I want to, starting from there, I want to do something different. So, for example, in this specific case, I want to use for the menu, I want to use a different font that is Cosmic Sans Serif MS, and also a different color. And so, to do that, it's enough to, of course, to implement the look and feel in Java or Scopus in object-oriented. And when you run Scopus, you need to decide which kind of look and feel need to be used. So, as you see here, I put the name of the Java classes that I have created. Again, you can create also this. I use Java, but you can use Scopus without problem. If you run, the same COBOL application can be runs with a different face. So the menu have a different fonts, the menu have a different color, and you can decide basically to go in the component and do some adjustment also in the way that the component is rendered on the screen. In addition, if you see, we can come back in this example. We have the internal object. There is a special tabs with internal object. This is the internal object that we support. I talk about a spooler, so I want to show you what means. Basically, the spooler the print preview things is this things. So you see basically pretty nice component. Your print cobble print report, your cobble print programs can be redirected to on the screen without any effort, just to say, I want to have this. Instead to go to the file, go to the screen. And we do all the job without bug you, all the things without bug you. And even more, if you want to customize the way that we design this user interface, you can go in this customization and decide the button that you want to see, the zoom, the maximizer, a lot of aspects that allow you to customize basically our default system, our default thing that we provide in that case. Recently, we also announced another nice library. Many often, if you are a Scrabble customer, you use definitely the venue for your application. So this is the API that the API called W$menu is a API that allows you to create this menu. So you can create menu with color, with font, with icon, with a lot of stuff. Now you can say, I want to have a different style of menu. I want to have what now is called hamburger menu. Hamburger is done in a way that, of course, is your menu, but shown in a different way. This is nice because you can you are not forced to go in your COBOL code and change basically any time that you use the $menu, change the way to be shown. You can go in the main things and say, I want to change the default attribute, and any new menu will be runs like hamburger menu. This is pretty nice things. It helps when you want to run your GUI application inside a web browser using web client technology that we provided. And so it becomes, you know, when you run inside a web browser, the menu is the menu of the browser. So we need to give a different menu for to people that want to use. And this is the idea that we had. And this feature is provided in coming to 2022 beta. So this is, if you like that, or anything that you see, is a good moment to go and download our beta that will be available next week, by the way, and start to play with these things. Marilyn. Thank you. Interoperability. Discover interoperability, this is picture, show you basically all things that you can deal with Discover. As you see in the name, of course, it means that your COBOL application with the API or statement or feature that we provide can deal with C or C++ language using native DLL or sharing library. We have a totally full and very well designed native interface. If you have something that you want to do in native, you can do and call from COBOL without any problem. Of course, you can call Java because Java is our main We everything that we design is written in Java. So when you run Discover, at the end you are a Java application. So we have a very nice Java interface that I will show you later. Of course, you can use also Ole and ActiveX with third-party tools in case that you need Java server page servlet. SOAP and REST service. I want just to spend a few times on this. This is pretty modern and up-to-date technology. Discover provides a pretty nice way to create a web service. Web service can be SOAP and REST. In the I don't know if you met in previous webinar, but we made a webinar on this technology where there is a real cases of people that create an application based on REST service, and this is the new way, the modern way to design application today. And because of that, Discover provided this capability. We provide this capability in a way that don't force you to deal complex stuff of service. We, from your COBOL application with link section based, it's enough to say, I want to create a web service for this link section problem. And we do all complexity. Our compiler create all stuff to hide your complexity. Even if you decide to use SOAP on REST service, basically we generate all stuff. Same thing for Java. I want to go now in the next slide that basically introduced the demo of Java. And Merely, maybe you can give, before to go, basically, then we will make this demo. Java interoperability. I want to spend again something more about on Java. We have Java, Discover is Java. Java gives us a lot of power. So you see in the very beginning of this webinar that how easy could be from a COBOL program called a Java object that you have and do things in a very different way. So basically, the capability with Java is with object-oriented, of course, because we can use everything of Java using object-oriented syntax. But of course, we can also tell and give to Java developers that maybe are inside your team the capability to call your COBOL program that was designed in a way that was not object-oriented way, but was a procedural way. But it's good. We can also keep advantage of this and allow people from Java to call it without any complexity or difficult or limitation. So you can say, I have a COBOL program where there is the business rule. Business rule is the first one, is the most important thing of COBOL, keep the business rule, but expose it in an easy way to everybody. So everybody can be HTML application that use service, but also Java people, Java application that use Java. So you can directly allow people that use Java to call your COBOL, legacy COBOL program with business logic. In two way, we define two different way to do that. One way is a little bit more complex because is a way that Java, so is an API at the end, that from Java we expose some methodology to call COBOL application and describe the link section structure of the COBOL data. This is the thing that in Java don't exist. No one have knowledge about COM3, COM6, COM5, ACE9 user display and so on. So we need to provide a strong interface to define these things. As a next step, because sometimes Java developers are not familiar with these things. So they are not familiar with the group, they are not familiar with redefined, things like that. So we decided to generate what we call the bridge that expose basically the same way to call, to use basically data in the linker section, but through setter and getter methods. This is a more familiar way for Java developer to use stuff. In the demo that I want to show now, I want to show basically the two technology at the same time, starting from, let me close this. Now is, okay. Two different things, but basically not complex. Easy problem. You can find this example in our distribution. So basically here we have a list of COBOL program that we want to call from Java. You see, COBOL program are legacy, what we call a legacy COBOL program. So they are based on linker section. As you see, a pretty complex linker section with a lot of COBOL stuff inside. And the idea is say how Java developers can call these things. So if I go in Java, basically Java developers have API that we provided in order to call COBOL program. The API is called this COBOL call, pretty easy, where there is name of COBOL program. And of course, we need to describe the link section definition. So link section definition is done to the interface that we call a COBOL van Eppel. COBOL van Eppel, there is a pretty Java document that explains how to be used, but I want to see basically a compactization. This is the linker section. This is the definition that a Java developer is forced to do in order to deal with this COBOL program. As you see, there is a kind of, you need to have a minimum knowledge of PIC-X objects, PIC-X S9, PIC-X COM3. These are described, of course, we describe, we document, but sometimes again, Java people don't like. They are not maybe so much familiar with this, even if this is pretty useful. This is the first interface that we provided. And so when you run it, you see that basically the COBOL program works without problem. You have, if there is something that there is an error, you say call not found. So basically everything around you can trap from COBOL, from Java, the fact that a COBOL program doesn't exist or doesn't work. So definitely it works perfectly. But we do a nicer job starting to say, to tell to our compiler that with the technology that we call it the easy linkage, that we want to do basically starting from a COBOL program. This is similar. This technology was developed a little bit in advance for the technology that we develop for web service, and it introduce to us the idea to do the web service. But basically, you have a common program with link section, nothing more like this, and through a compiler option that you can provide as a property or as an option, that is a compiler is a linkage through, when you compile, this program generate a Java programs that is basically a bridge, that this Java program expose all Java stuff that are necessary for a Java developers to call this common program. So from Java point of view, the things now are more easy. Let me see. You see here, we need just to say from Java to create an instance of the bridge and then set, with set, set the value. We say set, nevertheless, the number is conf-free, we don't care in Java. Of course, we care in the bridge, but from Java developers don't need to care if it's a number, if it's a comp, if it's a, you need just to set value, run, of course, the Cobol program. And when you run the Cobol program, that is basically this kind of method invocation, get the results. And the results are returned in the same way. So you have the instance of object, and you have the object, and of course we can, in Java is useful to say we want to get the result and convert to string, to double, to float, and things like that. So if I run it again, nothing different, I have the execution, very pretty easy. So the Java program, the main Java program, called the Cobol program, but for Java, this is a familiar. So they are not forced to deal with Cobol stuff. They just call it and use object and that's all. And for your point of view, your Cobol is still Cobol. So it's linked section based, nothing changing, can be called from another Cobol program without any problem. There is nothing that force you to transform or to change it in any way. Next, Marilyn. Now I want to introduce you. The next slide. That is regards the fact that is Cobol. We continue to improve our technology. We like to say any Cobol version that we release in bet is better and richer than previous one because we provide new feature. We fix bug. Of course, we have bug as you. All applications, so we fix bug, we made a better code, a better generation, faster things, and we try to keep also our technology up to date. This is a nice example. In there is cases in our Java generation that we use what in Java are called inner classes, and we use inner classes because sometimes we was forced to use inner classes in the Java generation that we do. And so because the users or inner classes, at the end, when you compile a Cobol program, so the fact that you get, because inner classes are generated from Java as a single classes in terms of as a file from file point of view, you get a lot of classes that can be generated. So many often people don't like the idea to have one Cobol program that become 100 Java classes. This is definitely not nice. It's not nice. Not nice from performance point of view because definitely no problem at all. It's not nice because maybe when you need to go to deploy your application, you have a thousand of classes. Instead, you prefer to have maybe less classes to be deployed. So maybe you forgot one classes and so the execution doesn't run. So there's many things where the Java class, having too much Java classes for one compilation, one source compilation is not a good thing. So because of that, we see that in Java now there is a nice capability that is called Lambda. And because Lambda was not aware, was not in the Java when we start. We start when we design this combo with Java 1.4. Lambda become in Java 1.8. So definitely we decided to switch because now most of our users already use Java 8 and maybe Java 9, 11, but basically no one's using the older version of Java. So because our adoption of Lambda, basically this adoption allow us to reduce a lot the classes, a lot. Basically, there is a situation where we have just one classes. So what usually Cobol people expect, one Cobol program become one Java classes. We keep advantage also with this technology to have For debugging, usually we add an additional classes we generated when we want to debug. And so we remove also these classes. But in debug, we keep, we adopt what in Java is called SMAP. SMAP is a technology that is described in the JSR 45 of Java, where you can basically put something that you like in the classes, not just the bytecode, thing that you need. So we start to use this in the recent version of Discover to, for example, for the code coverage, we use a lot of these things. But basically, for debugging, we decided that, of course, it's an option that you can go ahead to also to have in the Java classes the source code of COBOL. It simplifies a lot the debugging because before this implementation, you was in order to debug your COBOL application, you need to have the source code and also the classes, and both need to be to stay on your machine. And so when you go on a custom machine and you want to debug, you need to go with your laptop having the source code. With this capability, you can compile and say, I want to have the source code inside the Java classes. And we include it. We, thanks to SMAP, we include it. And we include it in a smart way. So we encrypt it, of course. We don't want that people can get your code, of course. So we encrypt it. Another addition that in announcement that we made in 2020 R2 is basically remove the dependence of tool.jar that we had in the past. That tool, this tools basically is for the compiler. When you compile a COBOL program, we compile the COBOL program, then we generate the Java source code, and then we compile the Java source code. In order to do that, we use tools.jar to do this task. And now, starting from Java 6, was provided a package called Java Compiler API, and so we take advantage of this in order to compile. This fact basically simplify for us the way that the product need to be installed, but also it give us a faster compilation because at the end we use the new way for Java to compile programmatically from your COBOL program. And so having this feature, you will find it in the coming beta. Next, please.
All right, we have Java Lambda demo.
Okay. Nice. Let me close something of previous demo. We need to have someone that close a thing from our previous demo to simplify. Let's go to Lambda. I have a little example of Lambda. Let me find it. Okay. Lambda, still closed. So Lambda, basically, the example is a COBOL program. Where we force, we stress the capability to use the inner Java and to show you what means. Basically, there is some area that in COBOL, that if you use something in COBOL, then we generate inner classes that are, for example, in the screen section, the capability to use variables, course variables in the screen section or function. Say you say function lang in this section, think like that. Basically, reference modification. So basically, this is a screen section where we use many of. And the problem for us that any time that you use, we generate inner classes. What means? If I compile this code with all the version of this COBOL, and go, this is the classes that are generated. You see, a lot, just for one COBOL program. So we have the main. Is Java. This is the inner things, the inner Java, where the debug classes. So too much, definitely too much. And you can understand if you miss when you copy these classes in your deployment environment, and if you miss something, there are 67. If you miss classes at the end when this program is run, you have you get an exception because there's a class that is missed. So you can see if you forgot to copy one, it's a big deal. So what do we do? Just switch into the new compiler. Let me show you. Now I can force the project to use a different compiler. I use a 2021, but I can use the embedded. The embedded is the beta, and just recompile, and you see that after the compilation is faster. Of course, I don't need to generate so many classes, so it's definitely faster, just one classes. So it's nice. One classes where you have in also the debug included. So definitely this is a very nice announcement because it's, everything, when you do less stuff, everything can become more easy, more nice to be seen. Next slide, please.
Okay, here we go.
This is the last one. No, but of course not the less important. This is definitely, I want to spend, Marilyn, in a previous webinar introduced the concept that we need to think not just to modernize our application in the way that application can be showed to the user, but also to modernize the way that our developers design the application. So I decided to go there and show basically a very small demo of the full cycle of development that you can use today with Discover. Discover, thanks to the fact that it's written in Java, it simplifies a lot some integration. But the idea, basically, you can start to design your application with our IDE, because we have an IDE, but you can use also editor like VI, I love VI, or any kind of editor you like. But the most things, the source code, need to stay in a version control system. In this demo, I will show you SVN, Subversion, but you can use any kind of version control system that you are familiar, like Git, or if you are not familiar, SVN is not bad. We use SVN, and we love it. Of course, when you need to create a real application, you need to have a script that basically made in automatic way, made all step of compiling, testing, deployment, setup of your application. And so pretty famous, one of the first one and famous of Java world is Apache Ant. Is written in Java as well, and basically you can of course use other ones. There's Maven, there's many things, but I want to show Ant because it's one of the first one and is one that we use the invariant from the very beginning. And of course, when you have created your script, you need to have someone that is sometimes during the time need to say, I want to run the script automatically and give you additional things. So this software, I call it continuous delivery software. And one of the most famous is Jenkins, that is based on Anderson, but there is an open source product. So what you see are open source products, so you can use, and of course, up to you to use or change and things like that. When you have Jenkins can keep your Ant script and run it automatically. Jenkins can download your source code from the SVN automatically in using rules that you can define. And at the end, you have the result to have your COBOL application that is compiled and tested and available for everybody. If I see now, if Marilyn give me the access to the system, I can show you the environment. This is Mac. Let's switch again on Windows. But for this demo, I need to speak a little bit about another machine that is a Linux machine here. It's an Ubuntu machine, where there is the SVN. SVN is based on this machine. I try to say SVN usually is another machine, it's not your developing machine. Is a machine, is a repository somewhere on the network. Here is the SVN, like the Jenkins are on Linux. So even if we show you the demo on Windows, definitely all things are run here. In this repository, there is a project with some source code, that cover source code. So the idea is, okay, let's start to, in which way we can get the source code. So first of all, we need to open the SVN view perspective. And so here we have basically the view of our source code. But basically, this is the view of SVN. And we want to have the project in the IDE to work on it. So it's pretty easy. Just say checkout and say, I want to check out here. OK. And now what I'm expected to have is the project here that is checkouted for me automatically. This is a project, it's a COBOL project with COBOL programs. This is the list of COBOL programs that you can see and can change. But you can see there is a little different in the decoration of the icon, because SVN comes and tell, come on, there's a little bit images that this, it means that this COBOL program is committed. And there is a little number that tell us the revision of this COBOL program. So for example, here I have test 4, 30 revision. Revision, what are? Well, basically, are basically, you can see the history of revision. So you have basically all means all times that I commit something on the SVN. So I have many, many committed, so 30 committed on the source code. But the nice thing is that I can go there and see anytime the status of my previous commit. So for example, I can go there and say, I want to compare the version 25 with the version 24 or with the version 30. And so if there is something to compare. And the nice thing is that immediately the source code comes to you in the line that is different. You see how the line is different, so it was my commitment. So you can see also the author of commitment. So you have a lot of information. So if you have more than one people that work on application, you can understand who committed what. And if there is something that become wrong, you can say, okay, I want to come back to previous version because this doesn't work. In this specific case, Discover Pro, this example, I show you how to use our test facility. Let's see where it is here. Okay. So I executed. So basically, this COBOL programs runs and say, I've run this four COBOL programs, the list. Runs means I've compiled and execute because it's COBOL provide also the unit test capability to execute a test cases. And the test case doesn't fail. As you see here, basically nothing failed. So it works fine and well. And of course I can make a mistake. Later I will make a mistake to have this test failed. But the concept is, this is a COBOL program that I can compile and run. The IDE do that for my automatically, but I want to integrate it with the SVN and ANT task. So the next step after the fact to have the source code inside a revision of a version control system like SVN is create a ANT task, a ANT script, sorry, in order where you can define the step that you want to have to accomplish the compilation. So here, for example, we have this is a pretty simple ANT script. It's XML based. Maybe you are not familiar, but let's try to be focus just on important stuff. So this is the compile. This task, that by the way, is a task that we provided in coming beta to simplify the usage, basically allow you to compile all things that are CBR, star.cbr, that are under source code are compiled. So I need just to say the directory and this task, when executed, it will compile. We have different targets in ANT that say basically are the areas that need to be executed. So for example, if you see the default here, you can also have an outline of view. We have the default target is build. Builds runs before to be runs, clean target, compile target, and test target. So clean is for cleaning, it removes the classes. Compile, we just see, very easy, and run is just to execute the run test. Mission one. Yeah, and test. So here basically we have the real execution of the COBOL program in this case in the Unistar. Is that once I have the script, I can run it locally if I like, just to see what's happening, if it's wrong, if it's not, it's correct or not. So I can run it. As you see, this is what you expected to have. So no errors, basically. The compiler compiles six source COBOL source. This is the COBOL source that was compiled. The test don't tell us nothing, so I suppose that everything is run without problem, and the build was successful. This is basically the script say, I do the job for you because I compile it and I run, and everything is done fine. Now, we need to start to think, we want to do the next step. The next step, I don't want to run manually this test. I want someone from that run it for me. So let's switch to Jenkins now. Here we have the job defined. The definition of the job, basically, you can go there and tell to Jenkins some important things. Important things are where the source code are. So the source code need to be downloaded from the repository. So the repository in this case is this machine where is the source code. This is the fourth thing that you need. Of course, as you see, there is many source code managers that you can use. Then you need to tell what is the building environment. We decided to use ANT. and because we write Ant script, and so you need to say what is the target that you need to be run. So build is the target that need to be run, and then we can see in which way the scheduling of the scheduling means how much time this process can be executed. I put 1 minute, so every minute Jenkins go to the SVN, check out the source code, and then run the build if it's necessary. As you see here, you have basically a state that give you that the sum means that build is stable. So I can go there and say the list of building. I can run locally, save. In these cases, I made an errors in the COBOL, so calling a program that doesn't exist, and so then I can run it. And as you see, basically the test is failed.
So I'm going to go back to my screen, and that is the end of the webinars. I have some links there on the screen, but they're also in the links in the handout. So remember to get that. If you have any questions, here's some emails for you. sales@variant.com or support@variant.com. We'd love to hear from you. There's a short survey after when you exit. I'd appreciate it if you filled it out. Also, please go to our YouTube channel and subscribe. I'm trying to get enough subscriptions so that we can get our name on it. And I appreciate all of you coming. Thank you very much.